Thanks, Randy. Boy, I'll tell you, after listening to the last speaker, if I was in the shale play, I'd go and throw myself under a bus. The story that you're about to hear has a little different outcome. First slide, please. Wait, there are no slides. Oh, my God, I'm still up on the screen. No, Connie, I'm really a lot taller than you thought I was. In 1991, as an independent exploration geologist, I had a couple of clients, having survived the crash of 1986, and we went out and looked for a large natural gas play. I had been working since 1971 in Wyoming, primarily in tight gas sands. I was on the original Natural Gas Potential Committee, I think it was 1974, sponsored by the U.S. Geological Survey. And I had spent most of my career doing exploration and development in Wyoming, especially western Wyoming, where the average reserves by 1990 for tight gas sands was 1.5 billion cubic feet of gas per well. Or maybe 0.95, you know, if you used a really, really tight decline curve. In 1991, my clients came to me and said, go visit this little company, you know all the people in there, and see if there's a project that you would like to acquire. And I did that. The company was Presidio. They had acquired a natural gas play when they purchased Home Petroleum, that had acquired a natural gas play when they had acquired Davis Oil. And this had sat on their books for years, utterly and totally non-commercial. And so my partners and I picked this little play up. It was 34,000 acres, three non-commercial gas wells that had cost $6.6 million to drill and complete. It had been an utter failure forever. Included in this package, we discovered sitting on one of the well sites, was $330,000 of the best commercial stainless steel tubing, which we rented out year after year to other people who needed frack jobs. The entire play had been viewed with disdain for many years. A famous geologist, an old friend of mine, Jim Barlow, had said, "There is no gas in the Farson Deep." And if you don't think that people believed him, I put this project together. We acquired our additional lands from the feds and the state, 100,000 acres, of which 40 acres was fee. 40 acres of fee. This was a high desert valley, 7,100 feet. You could walk between the plants. There were no trees. It was really a rather nice place to go and build a natural gas field. I put the play together, and my partner John Martin and I from McMurray Oil showed this to 27 companies, companies that are basically ruled by engineers. I lied to them miserably. I told them that there was a trillion cubic feet of gas under this 100,000 acres. They asked me how much of it would be commercial. I said, well, based on the basin-centered gas model, which was a wonderful exploration tool devised by Ben Law and Chuck Spencer of the U.S. Geological Survey, I said, there's a sweet spot in the middle of this, and I think we might be able to get commercial gas out of 20 or 30% of it, 200 billion, 300 billion cubic feet of gas. Well, of course, Randy has already stolen my thunder, though I don't believe it's really 13 trillion recoverable. It's probably more like 9 or 10 million, billion, I can even say it myself, trillion recoverable. We developed Jonah based on the idea that the frack technology of the past, especially demonstrated on the Pinedale Anticline directly to the north, had been a failure of technology. It had created formation damage and water imbibition and all kinds of problems of chemistry. And it wasn't that the gas wasn't there, and it wasn't that there could be commercial gas there, but that this was a technological play. Well, funny thing, guys, my beautiful geological model, which, by the way, the buying outline covered the entire field, 33,000 acres, except for 40 acres of the field, was wrong. It took me 4 years to figure out that the geological model did not fit the facts. And being fact-based, just like you, I couldn't stand the idea that I couldn't resolve the difference between the data that I was accumulating and the model. And so in 1995, 1996, I actually created a new model called the compartmentalization model. Jonah is not a basin-centered gas play. It's actually a structural trap. It's structurally defined by vertical faults. The gouge zones of those faults are probably not more than 30 feet thick. And yet, at 10,000 feet, there's over a 1,000 PSI pressure differential on one side of the fault to the other. The engineer said, that's impossible. Just look at the diffusion equations. Over geological time, you couldn't maintain this. But in fact, it's true. Wells have been drilled on both sides of that fault and found this pressure regime. As we developed Jonah, it became apparent to us that the Pinedale anticline, which had been a failure since 1957, was basically the same type of accumulation, but a different structure. Jonah is a vertically constrained fault-bounded structure, and the Pinedale anticline is an overthrust. But they contain the same elements of reservoir, of overpressuring, of structural containment. And so one day, sitting with my feet up at my desk, I looked at an EBCO auction, and there was one Wyoming property. It was one quarter of the New Fork unit on the Pinedale anticline, and we acquired it for $4,400, $1 an acre for held by production acreage. How was that possible? It was possible because people were constrained by their ideas. They were constrained so that they could not think outside of the box. And so I would like to talk about something that may not be entirely outside of the box, but certainly is different than the types of considerations that you've heard so far. A good dear friend of mine, Ray Thomason, talked a lot about this on lectures for the American Association of Petroleum Geologists. And it comes out of the concept of reserve analysis, and it's called the resource pyramid. How many people here do not know about the resource pyramid? In the 1920s, there was an academic, I'm not going to name names here, who published a paper, and his conclusion was, we were going to run out of copper in 10 years. There was a 10-year supply of copper, demand was rising, no new copper reserves have been found in the U.S. in a long period of time. We're going to run out of copper. In the 1930s, he published another paper and said, in 10 years, we're going to run out of copper. In the 1940s, anybody get this point? You know, he was not looking at the entire picture of resource versus reserves. For the most part, if you study commodities, you'll notice that there's roughly a 10-year supply at any given time in history of a particular commodity. And the reason for that is what Art was talking about. The present worth of additional exploration is virtually zero. So if you go out and you find 20 years supply, you have wasted your exploration and development money because you cannot get a return on your investment. But that doesn't mean that the resource isn't there. So without a slide, I want everybody to do a little thought experiment. And that is, consider a pyramid, a triangle with the apex pointing upwards, and put three bars across that, one up towards the top, one about a third of the way down, and then the vast majority of that down below that. The stuff on top is the production that we have already produced. It's the stuff that's gone away. It's the non-renewable resource that no longer exists. And the area below that on that resource pyramid is the known reserves. Everything below that is a resource. It is non-economic. It is not a reserve. What constrains that? The slope of that pyramid is constrained by price and technology. And I contend that the base of that pyramid is constrained by intellect. It takes new ideas to create new resource. It takes new technology and possibly changing prices to turn that resource into reserves. what we have seen in instances like Jonah Pinedale, which at one point probably added 15% reserves to the U.S., as we saw with Colben methane prior to that. I did the research for Amoco Production Company in 1976 on Colben methane. We were so successful, it was turned into an engineering production project in 1 year. No more science, all engineering. Colben methane demonstrated something that nobody could possibly imagine. Instead of parabolic or hyperbolic decline, incline. You pump the water off, you increase the production. And the first well we ever drilled in the San Juan Blanco field demonstrated that production relationship. You saw how many reserves are now attributed to Colben methane. It's a non-conventional resource, and yet it has replaced a huge amount of conventional production in the U.S. in a mere 30 years. I would contend that us scientists, geologists, I'll stand up a little taller, absolutely demonstrate this ability to come up with new ideas, to increase resources again and again, so much so that we tend to put ourselves out of business periodically. In 1973, the U.S. federal government, which constrained the price of natural gas under interstate commerce provisions, realized that, oh my God, we're running out of natural gas. Nobody was trying to replace those reserves. And so they re-regulated gas under these unconventional pricing structures. And all of a sudden, by 1976, we went from 25 cents a thousand cubic feet to $6 in western U.S. And what did we do? We created a gas glut that lasted for 10 years. We went out and found so many reserves, a lot of which were actually uncompetitive and non-economic when natural gas prices were finally freed up in about 1980, and gas became a fungible market commodity. And prices in western Wyoming dropped from those fixed prices of $6 and in some deep plays $10 per thousand cubic feet of gas to about $1 or $1.50 in MCF. Point of fact was that Jonah was an economic failure. In 1995, after expending $10 million and drilling 8 wells, we received 55 cents a thousand cubic feet at the wellhead. Almost threw myself under the bus that time, but you got to be an optimist, right? And in fact, natural gas prices turned around. We demonstrated, virtually over the dead bodies of every engineer who ever looked at it, that there was over 6 billion cubic feet per well there. Jonah has been described, and Pinedale as well now, as the most concentrated natural gas accumulations of the U.S. We broke all the rules there. We created a new model for natural gas development. As most of you know who have been around for 30 or 40 years, we used to drill natural gas wells on one well per square mile, 640-acre spacing, and then 320-acre spacing. When I started putting Jonah together, the first wells were drilled on 160-acre spacing. I couldn't imagine drilling on 10-acre spacing, no less 80s. And if you look at the map, you'll see that you can't drill 80s or 40s or 20s if you've spaced your wells on the centers of 160s. Everything is offset. And so there are these little discontinuities of drilling pattern in that field because we couldn't imagine what was in store for us. Jonah was basically a horizontal only vertical where you follow a very, very thick section. Instead of a thin section horizontally, you followed a very thick section vertically. But in fact, you drained an extremely small area. 5 or 10 acres. And so Jonah became the poster child for industrial development in natural gas. If you look at it from space, it looks very much like a prairie dog colony. That usually gets a bigger laugh. I give these talks to environmental groups these days. So Jonah became the model for increased spacing development for natural gas around the West, which has contributed many, many TCF of unconventional gas to the reserves of the country. I think you can all tell that I'm a real optimist. It's not that Jonah and Pinedale are 40 trillion cubic feet of gas. It's not that thinking out of the box in 1976 brought the development of coalbed methane. It's that human ingenuity is boundless. When I worked for Shell Oil early in my career, they had a beautiful geological model. It was the shallow water sedimentation Gulf of Mexico, Mississippi River model, and it demonstrated that if you look for oil and gas and sandstones below a water depth of a few hundred feet, you're out of your mind. Oops. I consider Shell a wonderful company full of brilliant scientists, but oops, you know, they couldn't imagine shallow water sands and deep water sands in 3,000 feet of water. They simply couldn't. And yet, there were geological models out there that could have demonstrated that there were high-velocity sand development at very deep water depths driven by ocean currents. You don't look for it, you don't find it. And so I'm absolutely thrilled with the shale plays. Consider what a groundbreaking new model that is. Jonah covers 33,000 acres. It is tiny. And in point of fact, the beautiful Jonah model that I created, used as an exploration tool, has not found a lot of other Jonahs out there. I hate to think it's unique, but it's certainly not common. Whereas the shale play covers vast areas, virtually entire basins, and gives us an economic model, whether it succeeds or fails economically, of course, only time will tell. But gives us a model to pursue very large quantities of unconventional reservoir. It has created a vast new area underneath that resource pyramid that was not there before somebody came along and said, this combination of geology, this combination of drilling technology, and that combination of frack technology will bring us successful results. I'm a great fan of natural gas. It was, you know, my career, and it made me a fortune. On the other hand, for 30 years, I've been preaching, and I'll preach a little bit now, even though I believe there is some discussion at this meeting about this. For 30 years, I have preached about nuclear energy. Now, that might seem funny because successful development of nuclear energy would have replaced natural gas in electrical generation. But I want to talk about that because I see a serious failing of American culture here in the lack of development of natural gas. Nuclear. Nuclear is the evil, invisible poison that's going to kill you and your children. Nuclear energy is bombs. It's meltdowns. But I want you to think a little bit about nuclear energy for just a few moments. First off, how many people have been killed in nuclear power plants since the development of this commercial technology as compared to refineries, natural gas plants, coal-fired plants? Anybody know? The answer is zero. It's zero. Nobody's ever been killed by a nuclear power plant. Thank you for bringing up Chernobyl. Chernobyl was a military installation built with 1947 technology that was abandoned by the U.S. as too dangerous in the 1940s. It was not a commercial power plant. It was the failure of the Soviet hegemony for the acquisition of atomic weapons. Chernobyl was not a commercial power plant. Anybody want to argue that? We'll do that at the end of this. In 1973, the Arab oil embargo scared the heck out of the U.S. People piled up and they filled their gasoline tanks and they ran out of gas and everybody was all upset. But the truth was, in 1973, we got almost zero of our oil from the Middle East. We didn't buy any oil from the Arabs. 1973, our oil came from Venezuela, Mexico, Canada, and Indonesia. Not 1% came from the Middle East. It had no impact on us, but it did on France. France was burning bunker fuel in electrical generation, and they said, never again. And they designed a safe nuclear power program. They designed several different plants that could operate in different geographies and geological settings. The guy who runs the plant in Marseille can drive up to Brittany and run the same damn plant. He doesn't have to be retrained. Every plant is not different. In fact, every plant is the same. How many disasters have happened in France since then? None. It's operated perfectly. What's the electrical generation in France? 85% nuclear. Okay, but you can say, well, what about the nuclear waste? And this is a political, not a scientific or technological disaster. So I'm going to give you 2 minutes of history, probably fractured history, about nuclear waste. Atomic Energy Commission went to radiochemists and said, those little fuels rods create some really toxic stuff and some very, very hot, short half-life isotopes. How long will it take for those things to decay away and not be dangerous? They said, wow, it doesn't take very long, really, but we better come up with a reasonable number. So how about 2,500 years? By the time they published the report, it was 5,000 years. When the Atomic Energy Commission got done with it, they presented it to Congress, and they said 25,000 years. And Congress said 50,000 years. There's science for you. Congress then went back to the U.S. Geological Survey and said, we need to find a stable place to store nuclear waste. We need 50,000 years of geological stability. Geologists said, holy cow, we can't guarantee anything like that. There's global tectonics and continental drift, and there's volcanoes, and there's earthquakes, and there's landslides, and there's, wait a second here, but there is a great place to store nuclear waste. How about an abandoned salt mine? Anybody know their periodic table? Chlorine has the largest neutron capture cross-section of any nuclide. That means that you could drill little holes, run those rods in there, and it would just suck up all the radiation and nothing would ever happen. Ah, but salt is really soluble. That's really bad. You could have floods, right? Wrong. It's so soluble that it's dry inside a salt mine because water can't migrate through it. It's too soluble. It immediately recrystallizes the salt. But what about the fact that salt is unstable? It flows. End of discussion. End of the ability to dispose of nuclear waste. The second part of nuclear waste is the definition of nuclear waste itself. Environmental advocates got the Congress to define nuclear waste as anything that becomes radioactive in a nuclear power plant. That means the entire concrete mass of the plant. But holy cow. If you guys hike in the high country and you hike across the Sherman or the Pikes Peak granite, it is more radioactive than the concrete of a power plant after 30 years. If you live in Denver, you get more radiation in 3 days than you got downwind from Three Mile Island. And so, ladies and gentlemen, between natural gas electrical generation and redevelopment of the nuclear power industry, we can really, really decrease our carbon footprint. It's the obvious solution to the need for baseload electricity. Thank you very much.